Welcome to our study of Genesis. Genesis is about the foundation of the Hebrew nation in covenant with God. The Old and New Testaments affirm that Moses was the primary author of Genesis to Deuteronomy. Although there are a few paragraphs that were probably not written by Moses, Mosaic authorship should be affirmed. Moses was trained in all of the wisdom that Egypt had to offer. God used his education and other experiences to prepare Moses to lead Israel. Genesis spans the time from the creation of the universe to the migration of Jacob's family to Israel in 1800 BC. The date of the writing is about 1445 BC, which is the time of the Exodus of the 12 tribes from Egypt. The first recipients were the Exodus generation coming out of bondage. Genesis provides a history of Israel's origins, a record of God's covenant with the patriarchs, and a theological framework to encourage them to possess the promised land. The main argument or summary statement for Genesis is that Yahweh Elohim, or the Lord God, creator of the universe, chooses and separates Abram out of a depraved world through his covenant so that he may establish a nation through the promised seed. A main purpose is to encourage the Exodus generation to obey Yahweh and enter the promised land by understanding the sovereign power and faithful character of Yahweh, who will fulfill his covenant through Abraham. Some key verses include Genesis chapter 12 and verse 3. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, but whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples of the earth will be blessed through you." Two other passages that close out Genesis speak of God's sovereign and providential care of Joseph in preserving the seed of Abraham. Genesis chapter 50 and verse 20 states, "You," and that's Joseph's brothers, Joseph speaking to his brothers, "you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." And those many lives refer to the 12 tribes of Israel. Genesis chapter 50 and verse 24 states, "And Joseph said to his brothers, 'I am about to die, but God will surely take care of you and bring you up from this land to the land which he promised on oath to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." Some major themes in Genesis are, in the beginning, God created, the origin of creatures and divine institutions. These are the generations of, which traces the genealogy of the tribes and the seed. Various names of God, particularly within those particular contexts. The Abrahamic covenant, which is not only central to the book of Genesis, but central to the entire Old Testament, and ultimately brings us to the New Testament, as out of the Abrahamic covenant comes the Palestinian or the land covenant, the Davidic covenant, which is Jesus Christ, King of Kings, and then the New Covenant, the Spirit of God dwelling in us permanently. The Lord's protection of the patriarchs and their wives. We see that marriage within the family community and faith covenant is vital. Sinful versus godly generations, the angel of the Lord, barren women who are then blessed by the Lord, circumcision, the covenant of the sign of Abraham's relationship and Israel's relationship to God, the father's blessings on the sons, and you will discover more as you read Genesis. An exegetical outline of Genesis sees the book divided into two major sections. First, the creation of the world by God and its degeneration by humanity's sin in chapters 1 through 11. Yes, Adam brought sin upon the whole world. In these chapters, we read that God creates the world and joins man and woman in union. The sinful obedience of God's creatures results in judgment. God delivers Noah's family and judges the world by a worldwide flood. God scatters the people from Babel. The second section is the election and separation of Abraham and his seed through covenant with Yahweh in chapters 12 through 50. In these chapters, we read that the Lord covenants with Abram and his descendants. The Lord strikes Pharaoh to protect Sarai. Lot separates from Abram, which leads to further conflict. Melchizedek blesses Abram and Abraham's victory in war. Then we see that the Lord expands the Abrahamic covenant, and Abraham believes God, and it is accounted to him as righteousness. Ishmael is born to Abraham and Hagar, but we see that the Lord is going to covenant with not Abraham and Hagar, but Abraham and Sarah's descendants by the sign of circumcision. We see the Lord's judgment on Sodom and Gomorrah because of their great wickedness. Once again, God protects Sarah from Abimelech. Just at the time that Ishmael was old enough to receive the blessing and the inheritance, the Lord God intervenes and provides Isaac, the promised son, to continue the covenant relationship. The preservation of Jacob's family is seen in the life of Joseph, God turning around the evil intentions of Joseph's brothers. Now let's put our feet into the sands of time so that we may read as it was intended from Moses to the Exodus generation. Imagine that your ancestors have been living in Egypt for 400 years. The Egyptians have wanted nothing to do with you except for the labor that you provide. They have a worship system with many gods, but the main Pharaoh is the mediator. He is the mediator between the Egyptian gods and the people. They worship gods that are represented by the earth and animals and the spirits of magic. God has just delivered you from oppressive bondage. God has demonstrated his sovereign power by inflicting the Pharaoh and his gods and the people with 10 plagues. You have crossed the sea on dry ground. You have watched the sea close up and destroy Egypt's elite army. You are now camped in the Sinai Desert awaiting further direction. God has commanded you to covenant with him so that you can enter the promised land and claim his promises. Your people are gathered, and Moses, your leader, commands you to listen to the word of God. The word of God contains history, ancestry, stories, covenants, and promises to encourage you to enter the promised land. What lessons should you learn from Genesis to encourage you to obey God and know that he will settle you in the promised land? Some examples are the problems that Abraham had when he went down to Egypt, or the importance of marrying within the faith and covenant family of the Lord God. These were two important lessons for the Exodus generation to learn when they entered the promised land. But as we know and we will read, they did not learn them. But you read so that you can know how great is your God. What should you learn from the successes and failures of the patriarchs? What is God's view of your enemies and the peoples who occupy the land of Canaan right now?